In this video, I'm going to show you how to approach setting up a Go web application. For persistence, we will be using a PostgreSQL database with a library called SQLX. Before you begin, make sure you have the latest Go toolchain installed. As of this recording, the latest version is 1.22.0. You also need PostgreSQL. The latest version as of this recording is 16.2. I will be developing this project using Debian 12 Bookworm, but the experience should be more or less the same regardless of your operating system. Create an empty directory named Goma and cd into it. Goma means sesame in Japanese. I consider this word to be a good code name for a project related to password authentication in Go. Not only does it begin with Go, the name of the programming language we are going to use, but it is also a reference to the story of Alibaba and the 40 Thieves, in which the phrase open sesame was used as a password to a treasure cave. Initialize a Go module using the command go mod init followed by a module path. This is going to be github.com/your github username/goma. Initialize a git repository using git init. Stage all changes in the working directory and finally create an initial commit. Now let's try to connect to a database. We're going to have to do two things: install some Go libraries and write some Go code. Let's start with the easy part, installing libraries. The first library I'm going to install is SQLX, which is a wrapper over the standard library database SQL package. Since we want to connect to a Postgres database, we also have to install lib/pq, which is a database driver for Postgres. On the website of SQLX, I scroll down to this snippet and copy and paste it into the terminal. Then I do the same thing for lib/pq. Now we're gonna need to set up a database and define a connection string. If you already know how to connect to a Postgres database using a connection URL, you can skip to the next section. First, make sure that you can connect to Postgres using PSQL. When you type PSQL in the command line, you should get connected to the default database, which is named the same as your system user. In my case, it is my first name, Karol. If you have just installed Postgres for the first time, you can run into this error saying that the role does not exist. You can solve it by running the command shown on the screen. The first part of the command means that the command in quotes will be executed as the user Postgres. The middle part means create a Postgres super user. The last part is an expression that your shell should replace with your username. If this command succeeds and you try to open a PSQL command line, you're going to run into another error saying that your default database does not exist. You can create a default database by simply calling the command createDB. Then you should be able to open a Postgres console using PSQL. Now let's set a password for the user Postgres. In general, when connecting to a database on your own computer, the username and password don't really matter. On the other hand, it is a common practice to use a default Postgres user with the password Postgres. Still, in the PSQL prompt, type the command shown on the screen. Make sure to wrap the password in single quotes and to end the command with a semicolon. If you see the message alter role, it means that you have successfully changed the password. Finally, let's create a database for the application. Since the project is called Goma, I'm going to call the database goma_dev. In the terminal, we can now easily connect to this database by typing psql goma_dev. But if you want to make a connection using Go, we need to write a connection string. On the screen, you can see a connection string in URL format. This string specifies that we want to connect to the database server at localhost using the username Postgres and the password Postgres. We want to connect to the database called goma_dev, and the part after the question mark means that we want to disable encryption because we are not going to need it in development. Now in the command line, type psql, then paste this connection string and wrap it in double quotes. You should be able to connect to the database just like before. Create a file named main.go and open it in a code editor. Define package main and func main. We're going to have to import SQLX and pq in this file. If your code editor has automatic imports, it should handle importing SQLX for you, but you need to add the pq import yourself and prefix it with an underscore. This is because the package is not directly used in this file. Paste the connection URL and define it as a string constant. In the main function, connect to the database using SQLX must connect. This function will panic if it doesn't manage to connect to the database. Now let's make a simple SQL query to check that everything works. Define a string variable called version. Execute a SQL query and scan the result into the variable version. If this method returns an error, log it to the standard output and exit, otherwise print the version variable. If you run this project, you should see the full version string of your Postgres installation. Now, obviously, hard coding the connection string inside source code is not the best way going forward, so let's move it out to environment variables. In development, I like to use a tool called direnv. Direnv lets you define environment variables in a file called .envrc. If you configure direnv correctly, it's going to evaluate the .envrc file every time you cd into a project directory, and it will set your environment variables. I won't be going into a detailed explanation on how to set up direnv on your machine, but you can read the friendly manual at direnv.net. Create a file named .envrc in the working directory. In this file, we can define variables using standard shell syntax. Let's export two variables. Set pgdatabase to goma_dev, then set database URL to the connection URL that we have previously hard-coded in the source code. Save this file and open a new shell. If you have configured direnv correctly, it should now display an error message asking you to run direnv allow. If you haven't, you can still set the correct environment variables by running source.envrc in the shell. You can check the value of database URL using the command echo. The pgdatabase environment variable sets the default database for PSQL, so if you type PSQL now, you should be connected directly to the database goma_dev. In the main.go file, define a function called mustGetEnv, taking a string argument and returning a string. Inside this function, read the value of an environment variable using os.getenv. If the value is an empty string, log an error message and terminate the program. Otherwise, return the value. Now replace the hard-coded connection string with a call to mustGetEnv. Since we are now using a function call, the value is no longer a stack-allocated constant, so we have to replace const with var. When you run the program, the output should remain the same. This is already looking great, but we can do even better by creating a database table and writing some data into it. In an application project, the best way to modify the database schema is using database migrations. These are essentially SQL scripts checked into version control that a migration tool will execute in the correct order. We're going to use a tool called Goose. It's a powerful migration tool written in Go. On the website of Goose, scroll down to this snippet, starting with Go install, copy it and paste it in your terminal. Then create a directory to store migrations at db/migrations. Now let's configure Goose using environment variables. Once again, open the file .envrc and add three new variables. First, set the migration directory to db/migrations. Then, set the migration driver to Postgres. Finally, set the goose db string to be equal to database URL. Open a new terminal. If you are using direnv, run direnv allow, otherwise source the .envrc file. Now, create a migration using goose create_users_sql. Make sure to use a space between the name of the migration and SQL. This command will create a new file in the db migrations directory. Open that file in your code editor. This file contains two sections, one named up for the changes we want to apply, and one named down for teardown instructions. The down section is optional. In the up section, remove the default content and add this statement to install a database extension called CIText. This extension provides a data type for case-insensitive text. We're going to use it for email addresses. Then we are going to create a table named users. We add an ID column, which is a 64-bit signed integer generated by the database and will be the primary key for this table. Add an email column, which is a CIText or case insensitive text, cannot be null and must be unique. Then add a column named password_hash, which is going to securely store the user's password. Finally, add two columns named inserted at and updated at. These columns represent the time when the record was created and updated, respectively. Both columns should be non-nullable and both should default to the current UTC datetime. In the down section, replace the default content with drop table users and save the file. Now in the terminal, run goose up. If you have set everything up correctly, the command should run your migration. Connect to the database, type /d users and press enter. As we can see, we now have a users table and the columns are exactly the way we wanted. When I started preparing this video 2 weeks ago, I was initially hoping to be able to show you much more than this. However, this proved to be a much more daunting task than I could have imagined. In the next videos, I want to cover password authentication using Argon 2, issuing access tokens signed with asymmetric keys, one-time passwords with TOTP, and WebAuthn, aka passkeys. If there is anything in particular you'd like me to cover, please let me know in the comment section. I hope you learned something, and thanks for watching.